So you want to learn how to make your digital art look traditional. And you know, applying thick paint strokes and canvas texture overlays to your art just won't cut it. Well, I'll show you what took my work from this digital mess to this. My name is Ludovico Clovis, and today I'm going to teach you the 3 steps to make digital art look traditional in Rebelle. So there are 3 steps to creating digital art that looks traditional. Step 1, studying your references. Step 2, selecting your brushes. And step 3, your painting process. Step 1, references. In order to know that your art looks traditional, you need to keep traditional art nearby. Here I have a John Siner Sargent painting. You can duplicate this process with any artist of your choice. With your reference selected, you now have to ask the following questions. What surface was this painted on? As we can see here, Sargent used canvas. What medium was used? This is actually important because watercolor and pencils behave different from oils and acrylics, and that can inform a lot of what you choose to do or which brush you choose to use. Sargent used oil. How thick is the paint? So we see that Sargent had a combination of thick and thin brush strokes. You can tell because of the grain of the canvas being visible. And I'll go deeper into why having canvas grain is important later on. What is the shape of the brushstroke? So Sargent's brushstrokes look rounded, and they could get thicker and thinner. So they could get like wider and thinner. What texture does the brush have? As we can see, Sargent's brushes had some hairy properties to them, and at times they look a bit porous. If we contrast this with an artist like Aziz Beck, we can see no porousness in this brushstroke whatsoever. And if you look at Sargent's again, you see a clear difference. There are holes in the brushstroke. So from what we've gathered from this reference, we'll need canvas texture as our surface, an oil kind of brush, a brush that can get thin and show canvas grain and build up and cover that canvas grain again. It needs to be able to be thin and get thicker with a kind of hairiness to it. It should be solid and be able to become porous and solid again. With this information, it's time for us to go brush shopping, which leads us to step 2, picking your brush. So with the information we gathered, we'll use this brush matching technique. You place your reference on your workspace, and then you go to your brush selector. Pick a brush you think will be good. Once you have that brush, test out a few strokes. If you like the way it looks, then you can color pick from your reference and then paint some strokes on the reference. And that's a little secret that I found to matching, is actually painting directly on top of your reference. So here we see that the brush stroke is the right shape, but it isn't hairy enough. So we're gonna need to pick another brush. So this one shows the canvas grain like we want it to. Let's test it on the Sargent. Okay, so it's the wrong shape, but it has a good texture. So what I'm gonna do is write down the name of the brush and the fact that I liked its texture. Now here's step 2.5. So you found some brushes that you like, but not all of them in one. So this is how you combine the brushes to make one super brush. So take the brush that you like and choose the property that you like. Open the brush creator and select between the two brushes to see what settings change. So there is one secret setting that I do look out for, and this one was a huge game changer. The secret setting is called Canvas Texture Influence, and it controls how much canvas grain you get. So if you copy the curve of the other brush, you'll see that the brush stroke starts showing more canvas texture. Now, when you combine this with the oiliness setting, so the more oil, the less surface will show of the painting surface, and the less oil, the more that surface is going to show up. Did I say that backwards? I don't know. After doing this, we now have a good brush that behaves like both of these brushes combined. Now we can move on to our process. So step three, process. So in order to make our brushwork look traditional, we need to structure our work like a real painting. A real painting has its surface texture here, represented by the squiggly line, and this dotted line is the paint. The first layer is thin, and you can see it doesn't fully hide the canvas texture. You can see how the bumps are kind of just sticking out. So our first layer should be thin with little oiliness. See, when we zoom in, the canvas texture is still visible. This is important. Then the next layer is going to sit on top of the squiggly line, but still follow some of its bumps. So our second layer should have less dark patches like these and fill those in. So I increase the loading a bit and go from there. Also notice I'm thickening the light areas mostly. This is because a lot of traditional artists keep their shadows thin and thicken the lights. So you're gonna get more of that traditional feel by doing something similar. Finally, the third and fourth layer sit on top of a much more smooth surface, showing no canvas texture whatsoever. So remember when I said showing the canvas texture is going to be important? It's because it contrasts, allowing us to be able to make that differentiation between thin and thick paint. So we increase our thickness again, and we paint the thicker areas, and then get as thick as possible for the highlight. As you can see, when we zoom out, it looks pretty good. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna move this over to the sergeant piece, and it looks good there too. So this is the exact same process I'll use to recreate this sergeant painting. So I start off just putting the first values and the first colors down, similar to how we start with the Saphir, except here there's just a bit more hue variation that I focus on, like even the background has a few different colors, but I focus heavily on blending at this stage and ensuring that it's not very thick, the paint that's there, so you can see the bottom of the canvas like I taught you. So you'll see the loading and the oiliness changing as I paint this piece. Also notice that I use the paint mode and then the blend mode. Personally, I like to be sure of the brush stroke that I lay down, and then I blend intentionally using the blending mode. So don't be afraid to blend, because sometimes there's some textures that you can only get through blending. As you can see, the loading has increased from when we started, so that we can build up that thickness and have that contrast between thick and thin. And you can see in some areas, the thickness is even more. Now, an interesting thing about brushwork is that it's also dependent on how you use color, because really a brushstroke is a mark that has a slightly different color than the previous mark, otherwise it would become one big mark. So if you have good understanding of color and proportions, then your brushwork will benefit from that too. When you look, there's a lot of greens and yellows and pinks inside this skin. And you'll notice some of your favorite artists having this hue variation inside their work. And now you see that as I'm increasing in thickness, I'm also increasing in oiliness in some parts, because what oiliness does is that it hides the canvas texture more, and that gives the illusion of thickness. You don't want to always just be completely thick but then have no oiliness, or else you'll get like bumps. Whereas the more oiliness is, the more it will look like painting on, your paint is building up thickness, really. So as we get into these highlights, I increase the thickness quite a bit, and I increase some of the oiliness. inside the piece. So I'm mostly satisfied with how the piece came out. If I had more time, I would have fixed some proportions, but just to show you that you can get a very traditional looking piece using this kind of process, I feel like this was enough to do that. And you can copy this process with any of your favorite painters and write down some of the things that you notice, write down the process, write down the brush that you used and the modes that you found yourself using. That way you can come back and recreate that kind of process with your own work. So just a quick summary, collect information about your reference, test different brushes that fall in line with what you found out from the earlier step, then refine those, and then finally follow a traditional painting process so that you can get traditional results. Your homework or a quick assignment that you can do to test this out is paint a sphere using these techniques. So it could be a little bit intimidating to do an entire master study or copy like I did, but just start off by painting a sphere because it's basic shapes that we use to build up and make things like noses, all of those things. So if you can draw a sphere or paint a sphere and paint a tube, a cylinder, then you'll be able to paint anything that you want. So I hope that this video helped you. Comment if you have any questions, and thank you for watching.